Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. Today we are back in Emilia Romagna. We had a series of webinars in the past few months, but this is specifically beautifully put together to talk about the beautiful food of gastronomy from beautiful Emilia Romagna. Specifically, the title is Food Treasures from Emilia Romagna, a journey through Italian home cooking with Casa Artusi. You will see it through the entire presentation how important Casa Artusi is to the whole story. And moreover, before we actually start, I need to explain to you that, of course, this webinar is part of the celebration of the 5th World Week of Italian Cuisine, and is, of course, organized by the Italian National Tourism Board of US and Canada, and the patronage, very important, of the Italian Embassy in the United States. And of course, I want to extend, of course, my thank you specifically to the ambassador, Armando Varricchio, and also to the executive director of the Italian National Tourism Board, Mr. Giovanni Bastianelli. Now, having said that, I welcome once again all of you that have been so loyally participating to our webinars. This is most likely the last one before the small break during the Thanksgiving. So I want to thank you, all of you. I want to thank the US friends and Canadian friends, and of course, also our new upcoming friends. We are very excited to have you all the time, our friend from down south, Mexico and Puerto Rico. So as I said, this webinar is going to be extraordinarily interesting. You already see the camera pointed to our speakers. This is the boring stuff is over. I'm tired of talking. I will actually going to present to you the two speakers that you see now on the screen. As I said already, I'm welcome back. This is already, I think it was the fifth time that we have with the webinar. We have Silvia Mazza. She's the travel marketing specialist of APT Servizi Emilia Romagna, which is none other than, of course, the Emilia Romagna Tourist Board. Thank you very much, Silvia. Ciao, benvenuta.
Ciao, Francesco. Hi, everybody.
And of course, we are very excited. Most of you have seen her. She's been in a lot of events here in New York, but also, of course, throughout Italy. She's our, you know, go-to person, specifically when we talk about the food, the incredible food traditions of Italy. I have Francine Segan. She's a food historian. She's an author and a public speaker and a personal friend. Ciao, Francine. How are you? Welcome.
Buongiorno.
Ciao. So I want to stop talking. I'm very curious. I'm hungry because it's already 12:40, so it's the perfect time. It's lunch break. So Silvia, walk us through it. I see you there. You're already at Casa Artusi. Tell us everything that we need to know about the beautiful tradition of food in Emilia Romagna. Ciao.
Sì, Francesco. You remember last time we saw, I was in the garden of the Grand Hotel. Yes, we met different times. And actually, you can have a look at the free webinars that we organized on the website of Italian Tourism of ENIT New York. But just to remind, for those who didn't participate to the other webinars, or just to remind you, where is Emilia Romagna? We will talk about the food and gastronomic treasure of our beautiful region. But let's have a look first, what has Emilia Romagna to offer? But basically, where is it placed in Italy? That we always say it is in the heart of Italy. Let's have a look to the map.
Perfect. All right. Okay, so many different things. Wow.
Okay, as you can notice, the main cities of the region are almost equidistant. So it is really a perfect way to visit our region, to travel along Emilia-Romagna. What you probably notice is the great amount of food delicacies, of food product that our region has to offer. So typical fruit product, some of them are the iconic product that represents the Italian cuisine, such as Parmigiano Reggiano or Parma ham, some other less known. But yeah, the best way to discover all the treasures of our region has to offer in terms of art, culture, activities, nature, but above all, food, the best way is to travel along Emilia Romagna. And to this topic, I am delighted to give the word to Francine, who actually did this kind of journey. She traveled along Emilia Romagna and find out all the beautiful gastronomic treasure that we have to offer. Isn't it, Francine?
You are muted. Ciao, Francine. Let's try this one again. Hello, Francine. So what? Go ahead.
You guys muted me?
No, you're on set now. Go ahead.
Thank you, Sylvia. As I mentioned, my trip along Via Emilia took place about 2 years ago, and it was a fantastic journey of discovery. I was already aware of the huge number of unique foods coming from Emilia Romagna, but I was amazed to learn that the number of special DOP and IGP products grew to 44, making Emilia Romagna the real food capital of the world. Now, it's important to note for some of our listeners that this is the highest concentration in the world, not just in Italy. And in case you're not familiar with these terms, PDO or PGI are in English, or DOP and IGP in Italian, they are quality certifications that the European Union awards to really underscore the value of food products that are very specific to a particular area, and they guarantee a quality standard to both the consumers, us, and to the producers.
Yeah, exactly. And Francine, I'm very curious to know, is there, during your journey, is there one or more food product that are your favorite product, or maybe from taste or from the history or from the procedures of making?
It's amazing. I was lucky enough to taste all 44, and so I love them all. But I have to confess that I actually have two favorites. Piadina, which is an incredibly delicious flatbread that I learned to make right there at Casa Ortuzzi. And the other product that's really dear to my heart is traditional aceto balsamico, especially as a food historian. First of all, one taste of this dense, flavorful, naturally sweet balsamico, and you love it. But what's interesting to realize is that it's aged in barrels, moving every year into a smaller and smaller barrel, so it naturally condenses and gets thicker. This series of barrels is called in Italian a batteria, and they're made from aromatic woods like juniper, cherry, chestnut, mulberry. I'm salivating thinking about it, because when you visit some of these aceto balsamic makers, you can smell not only the fabulous aceto balsamico, but this wood that gives it such a wonderful flavor. I also loved learning a tradition in Emilia Romagna, which is that a family, when they have a child born, starts a batteria. So it starts with one gigantic barrel, 100 gallons, let's say, and by the time the child reaches adulthood and gets married, the barrel is very small, maybe only a gallon is left, and that's given as a gift to the child and their spouse. Very charming.
Yes.
Yeah, it sounds like you really fell in love with aceto balsamico.
It's amazing. It's so wonderful on everything. It pairs so greatly. You just drizzle it on your wonderful cheeses, you know, prosciutto di Parma, grana padano. It's wonderful on so many of your products. Fantastic.
Parmigiano Reggiano, Francine.
What did I say?
Of course.
Grana padano.
Well, I mean, that's also a little Emilia Romagna, but
a Reggiano, small part, Reggiano. Yes, a small part. Yeah, you're right. You're right. But do we have a look to your journey?
Let's see.
Okay.
Very good.
Emilia Romagna has 44 DOP and IGP products, more than any other region in Italy. Travel along Via Emilia through what's been dubbed Food Valley and explore some of the region's specialties. Parmigiano Reggiano, traditional aceto balsamico, prosciutto di Parma, and mortadella di Bologna. Parma, a UNESCO city of creative gastronomy, is home to prosciutto di Parma, culatello, and Parmigiano Reggiano, which pairs wonderfully with traditional aceto balsamico. Traditional aceto balsamico of Modena is made from pressed grape juice cooked within 24 hours of picking over low heat until it's thick, sweet, and dark. Lambrusco wine, made from Lambrusco grapes, is one of the world's most popular Italian red wines, beloved for its rich flavor and easy drinkability. Bologna, the capital of Emilia-Romagna, is nicknamed La Grassa, the fat one, for its rich cuisine. Bologna is famous for mortadella, whose name comes from the Latin for mortar, which was used to finely grind the pork with salt, black pepper, myrtle berries, and other spices. Bologna is also famous for ragù bolognese, a meat sauce served with tagliatelli. To learn how to make tagliatelli, let's visit Casa Ortuzzi. Pellegrino Ortuzzi, he wrote one of Italy's most important cookbooks. It was written in the 1800s and it's dedicated to Italian home cooking. And so his birthplace created this wonderful center. Not too wide, not too thin. And the dough is very simple to make. It's just got two ingredients, flour and eggs. Now I like this trick that I saw the Marietta do. And then to go like this.
Ole, grandissima Francine.
And you make a waterfall of tagliatelle. The classic pasta shape for ragù bolognese, the meat sauce of Emilia Romagna. Butta la pasta. We're in the southern part of Emilia Romagna, in the Romagna area, at the popular beach resort town of Rimini, birthplace of famed film director Federico Fellini. This section of Emilia-Romagna has some of Italy's best truffles. Every Sunday in October, the lovely medieval town of Sant'Agata Feltria hosts one of Italy's most famous truffle events, the National White Truffle Fair. The fair is a great place to try the autumn delicacies of Emilia-Romagna: chestnuts, desserts, wines, cheese. Squacquerone is a DOP cheese of Romagna. It's often served spread on piadina, the traditional flatbread of Romagna, and one of Italy's most popular street foods. And for all the other fabulous foods and dishes of Emilia Romagna, visit
really a tasty journey, we can tell. Very interesting. Thank you, Francine. Thank you. But beside our 44 jewels, let me also mention very briefly our 30 certified wines and the 15 slow food procedure, as well as the 21 Michelin star restaurant from the 3-star Michelin star La Francescana of Massimo Bottura, the world recognized awarded chef, to 2 Michelin star, to 1, but also the many taverns and inns where you can taste a traditional home cooking. But yeah, today we focus on home cooking, being here in Casa Artusi in a cozy atmosphere. But before to get to the heart of our recipe, the tagliatelle recipe, I would like to tell you something more about the Casa Artusi. And to do that, I need to tell you something more about Pellegrino Artusi. Francine already said in the video, he is considered the father of Italian gastronomy. Well, let's try to know his history. He was born in Forlimpopoli, where we are. He was a bourgeois. After he studied, he started to deal with his father's business. Having quite a success, he traveled a lot around the country. And well, during his job trips, he was really passionate in home cooking. Actually, he had quite a lot of success, and he could retire early, so he could spend his time and dedicate his time to his 2 great passions, literature and cooking. Well, you might think that he was a great chef, a great cook. Well, not at all. He couldn't even fry an egg. But he was really curious and passionate in traditional cooking, in traditional recipes. And that's why during his many, many trips around Italy, he used to take notes of the local recipes. And year after year, he collected so many recipes that he decided to publish a book called Science in the Kitchen and the Art of Eating Well in 1891. He decided to publish this book at his own charge. Well, we can say the first edition was not really a bestseller, but something quite strange happened. Well, let me show the book first. Let me have a look. Right, this is the first edition and a later edition of L'arte, La scienza in cucina e l'arte di mangiare bene, Science in the Kitchen and the Art of Eating Well. Well, I was saying, after this first publication, something quite strange happened. He started to receive many, many letters, more or less with the same content, saying something like this: Dear Mr. Artusi, I read very carefully your book and I find it very interesting, but I noticed that you forgot to mention the recipe of my region, which is very, very popular. Or something else like, Dear Mr. Artusi, I read your book and I'm quite disappointed to see and to notice that you didn't mention at all the recipe of my city, which is a delightful recipe. So Artusi kept all this letter. He took note about all the recipes, and the number of recipes increased more and more. So the next edition, from 475 recipes, we reached the number of 790 recipes. Wow. So a book like this one, Jesus, that thick, Science in the Kitchen and the Art of Eating Well. You know, if Pellegrino Artusi would have lived in modern times, we can say that he would have been one of the most popular food blogger of our times, or maybe a very important gastronomic influencer. But actually, he had a big success with the next edition. And in 1930, after his death, the Artusi, this is the way we all call the book, was one of the most read book by Italian. So we really need to recognize the great tribute of having given to transform that incredible mosaic that was a regional tradition, regional cuisine, into a national gastronomic tradition. So this is the reason why we chose to celebrate the Week of Italian Cuisine here from Casa Artusi, because basically, if we can talk about Italian cuisine, this is also thanks to Pellegrino Artusi. Wow. He let us travel along Italy, around Italy, through the best way to let a country to be known, like just the mangiare, just eating the traditional recipes, eating traditional food. And that's what Pellegrino Artusi did. So that's exactly what we would like to do today. We would like you to travel with us with a traditional recipe. Casa Artusi, so today, is not just simply a cooking school where, like many, many other cooking schools we have spread out in Emilia Romagna, is something more than that. It's a center of gastronomic culture. So where we can learn about the legacy of Pellegrino Artusi. In Casa Artusi, you also find a very, very interesting library, which is the shrine of Artusi's of Artusi knowledge. There is also, with 45,000 volumes that Artusi collected, yes. There is also a nice restaurant and a wine bar where you can taste, obviously, Artusi's recipes, but also some other local recipes that are not mentioned in the Artusi book, as well as eating just a snack with a glass of local wine. So I think that we can go to the heart of the recipe. And for this, I definitely need the help of Carla Brigliadori, the head of Casa Artusi School. Carla, vieni da me. Vieni
Da ciao me. Carla, welcome.
Welcome everyone.
You saw Carla in the video of Francine as well. Yeah, she's always here when someone is making any classes. So, as we were saying, we will prepare tagliatelle, an iconic recipe of pasta. When we talk about Italian food, maybe the first dish that comes in mind to everybody is pasta. And talking about Emilia Romagna pasta, we talk about fresh homemade pasta. Mm-hmm. So today we will see tagliatelle recipe, but what is important to know is that the dough to make tagliatelle is exactly the same dough used for any other fresh homemade pasta, for tagliolini, ravioli, cappelletti, tortellini, any kind of fresh pasta is made with the same dough. And it has just two simple ingredients, flour and egg. But let's be more precise. Let's have a look to the recipe again. Okay, we are preparing tagliatelle for two person, because the recipe says, Artusi recipe says, that we need one egg per person with 100 gram all-purpose flour. So 100 gram is around 4 ounces. Okay, so the recipe for two person says two medium-sized American eggs. around 7 ounces of all-purpose flour, a little bit more, but around 7 ounces, a little bit of salt, and that's it. So we put the flour on our cutboard.
Facciamo il nostro cratere.
Yes, we do a crater. We form a volcano doing a crater in the middle.
E versiamo le nostre uova. Possiamo decidere di lavorare o con la forchetta, with a fork, oppure con le nostre dita, che sono i nostri migliori amici in cucina.
We start to work the eggs with the flour. We can decide to start with a fork or, as Carla said, with your fingertips, which are the best helper, the best tools in kitchen.
Lavoriamo bene il torlo e l'albume.
So we work them together, the yolk and the white.
E aggiungiamo farina.
You put flour, okay, like this. Okay. Take care not to break the crater, like that, okay.
A we mix. Mischiamo con i polpastrelli, farina e uovo.
Okay, we just mix everything together, flour and eggs.
E a questo punto usiamo il palmo della mano.
Okay, now you don't use not only fingertips, but you use the whole hand. You see something like this, really pushing.
Okay. Questo momento è molto divertente per i bambini. Ma anche gli adulti sono un po' bambini.
Carla says, also for children, they also organize some cooking classes for children, and this particular moment when all the little pieces are stuck to your fingers, it's very, very funny for children, but sometimes even for adults.
E formiamo il nostro impasto.
Okay, we form the dough and we work it. It has to be homogeneous.
E lo lavoriamo per circa 10 minuti.
For around 10 minutes. So although it seems that flour and eggs are mixed together, you still work it to make it really homogeneous, to make the really consistency.
Sì. Poi, lavoratolo bene, lo lasciamo, copriamo molto bene, che non prenda aria, e lo lasciamo riposare per circa 30 minuti.
Okay, we made it faster, but as we were saying, you had to work the dough for at least 10 minutes, and then you let it rest. Okay, so while we let our dough rest, let me explain you something more about Casa Artusi. The cooking school can accommodate 20 people at a time. They have 20 fully equipped stations plus one demo station like this one with cameras and with videos and with some chairs in front of us. So you can choose to have a cooking lesson with your hands on or just to have a demonstration to have a look how recipes are made. Could be both a combination. Obviously, 20 fully equipped stations in COVID time, there are 10 stations, although they are quite spread out to each other, but they already organized some cooking lessons even last summer, and they welcome not more than 10 people at the same time this crazy year. What is really, really interesting is that you can book your personal cooking class. It's not expensive at all. It can be even one person or a couple, for example. There are scheduled cooking classes that are in Italian. But yeah, as I was saying, you can really book your tailor-made class for example, for bigger groups, some of them, part of them, half of them can work here in kitchen, and the other half can work together with a sommelier, knowing the best combination with wines, and then they turned. Sure. Or in this crazy period, again, they also organize a cooking class online with Zoom. So it could be a nice idea that could be really an interesting and funny opportunity.
Sure.
Yeah, what is important is to have hands-on, because as Pellegrino Artusi says, experience is the best teacher. Practice is the best teacher. So I would like to share a short video about Casa Artusi and the activities they can organize here. Let's have a look to it.
Perfect. Thank you.
Here we are again. So once the dough is ready, you need to let it rest for at least 30 minutes. That's very, very important for the consistency of the dough. We obviously prepared a second dough so that now the one that we have here is ready to go on to proceed with the rolling section.
Of course. Here we go.
Okay, andiamo with the rolling section.
Allora, ricordiamoci che il rolling pin, o mattarello.
Okay, so
avanti indietro.
Yeah, the rolling that's work of a rolling pin, obviously, to roll.
Quello che gira è la pasta.
What is important is that you always turn your dough, trying to make a perfect round shape.
Okay.
So you always move it, you see? So that slowly, slowly it gets bigger and bigger, but always with a nice round shape. In case you need, you add some flour so it doesn't stick to the rolling pin.
Silvia, guarda il mio movimento di bacino.
Oh, Carla is saying we need to notice her hips movement.
Yes.
So you need to use the whole body, not only the arms.
Of course.
It's a question of passion. It's a question of love, you know, so the whole body is involved. Okay.
E tiriamo la pasta.
Tiriamo la pasta. We stretch the dough. We stretch it to make it bigger, to make it thinner, like this. It's a good gymnastic session as well for your arms. You know, in Romagna, we have a very funny joke saying that to prove the salt test, when you throw the salt, when you throw the salt, for ladies when my age, for example, sometimes the arm, the muscle is not anymore so tough, you know, so because so tough, we are not used anymore to roll every day. So this is a perfect gymnastic session.
The toning exercise.
The
salt
test. It's perfect. It's perfect.
That sounds good.
Oh, let me see. No, Carla has not this problem.
In watching this, I realized that now that so many children are not in school, they're learning at home, this is a fantastic lesson for a group of parents to get together and have their children make pasta, exercise, or learn shapes, weights.
Yes. Oh, Francine, you give me the possibility to thank you, first of all, for your great blog
post
that you published yesterday on our travel blog, Emilia Romagna Travel, about a typical menu of Emilia Romagna. I mentioned this also because a colleague of mine is a very, very good cook. And she posts once a week traditional recipes, showing also her children are helping her. It's really nice. She has two boys, two small boys, but they are fantastic, really fantastic. You can find the recipes on Emilia Romagna Travel blog.
There you go.
I loved writing the article because it's so easy for us here in the United States to entertain when we can purchase the wonderful products of Emilia Romagna and kind of have a taste of Italy since we can't visit right now. And so that menu I created really uses lots of the 44 products that we mentioned in the video.
Yeah, exactly. So the dough is now slowly taking the right shape, the right size.
So Sylvia, sorry, Sylvia, yesterday we were talking about, you know, like, of course, like how this sort of visit to the Artusi could be, an extraordinary sort of half day experience that from people that are visiting the area, that they can travel very easily there. So if we can give a little bit more information to the people who are listening to us, you know, how, you know, what you expect to see or have once you walk into the Casa Artusi, and moreover for Limpopoli itself and the area around, there's some people that are sort of managing the packages, or they are sort of thinking of what the client might ask them, how they can sort of incorporate this experience within a full day, visit to the area.
First of all, let me suggest to you that a very good period to visit Casa Artusi and for Limpopoli is during the Feste Artusiane, which is a festival dedicated. Artusiane is an adjective, so Artusi Festival. It is a street food festival. The whole little city of Fort Limpopoli will be full of booths coming from all over Italy. They organize seminars, workshop, but above all, you can taste wonderful delicacies of different typical street food coming from all over Italy. This is very, very interesting. They take place every year in June. Well, this year they have been postponed to the beginning of August, but they took place anyway in a small reduced edition, let's say. But anyway, let's try. Let's hope that we can do it again next year. Siamo quasi pronti?
I am ready.
Okay, I will go on later when tagliatelle are boiling. So our dough is ready.
Okay.
All right.
Prendiamo il coltello da pasta.
Okay, you need the pasta knife. It's not just a knife. You cannot use any knife, the first knife you find in your kitchen. You need a proper pasta knife, very shaped, with this kind of shape, very sharp.
Lo usiamo così.
Okay, so don't think to cut just like this. It's very important you start from the point and then down. That's very important. Little tricks. It seems that they are not important, but they are. They are just little tricks to make your recipe perfect. Okay, you fold the dough, and now we start to cut.
Di che misura le facciamo?
Ah, the right measure. Which is the right measure of a tagliatella? Well, basically, if you like it wider, you cut it wider. If you like it thinner, you do it thinner. But the right measures is 8 millimeters wide. And you know what? In the headquarter of the Regional Chamber of Commerce in Bologna, you can find a golden sample of a tagliatella to show exactly how they, how wide they should be and how long they should be.
Sure.
And attention, here we are at our tagliatelle waterfall.
Oh, wow.
Wow, ecco qua.
This is the best part.
Tagliamo.
And talking about...
Ma secondo te saranno abbastanza lunghe?
Would they be long enough? That's a good question. Because you know what? At this moment, I really would like to read a funny quote of Pellegrino Artusi from his book, talking about the measures of tagliatelle. So Artusi says... Bill should be short and tagliatelle long, the people of Bologna say. And they are right, because long bills terrify poor husbands, and short tagliatelle look like left lovers, attesting to the incompetence of their maker.
There we go.
So, as I was saying, the two passions of Pellegrino Artusi was cooking and literature. So some of the recipes, they are really like this, with some funny quotes, some funny way to tell the recipe, to describe the recipe. So you could use the whole dough, but we would like to show you some other example of pasta.
Yep.
Very simple.
Very simple.
So you cut some square, some small square of dough.
And
with this funny instrument, which is like a comb, you roll it on the stick and you have a garganelli, a kind of macaroni. It's basically a kind of macaroni, but fresh homemade egg pasta. This is garganelli. So this beautiful instrument used by Carla is the original instrument of 19th century, of early 20th century. Then this is the modern one.
Yeah.
And to see the difference, it's always the same concept, but it becomes a bigger. So this is the first one. This is the first one and the second one. So the first one, the small one, originally were eaten with broth. Otherwise, today it's very popular to have a garganelli with fish sauce. We are not far from the sea, so they are really delicious with any kind of fish sauce. And what the rest of the dough, which is left, you can just cut them like this with any particular shape to do some mal tagliati. Literally, is translation of a bad cut. You just bad cut your left dough, and they are perfect. For example, for pasta e fagioli, for pasta and beans soup. They're really typical.
Ecco.
Or?
Questi invece.
Have a look.
Sono I malfattini.
Tiny little pieces of pasta. Really small, really small. Okay.
That's
then
awesome.
Once they are tiny little pieces, you make some dots, some small little balls, and they are also very good with soups, with minestrone also, perfect in this season.
Beh, mi sembra
so
che...
we don't
waste anything. Everything has been used. Awesome. Fantastic.
Everything is used. In the past, it was very, very important not to waste anything. Okay. So our water, meanwhile, is boiling. So it is time. Oh, we add some salt. Very important. If you didn't do it before, you have to add some salt. And once it's really boiling, even more than the one we have here, as Francine was saying, buttiamo la pasta. Literally, we throw the pasta into boiling water.
Prendiamo le nostre tagliatelle.
Okay.
E lanciamo la pasta.
Right.
Ecco.
Okay, it's the fresh homemade pasta, so we need only 2-3 minutes to cook. So meanwhile, I can tell you something more about Forlimpopoli and the surrounding.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I would like to show you again the map to show you exactly where Forlimpopoli is. It is on the Via Emilia, on our famous Via Emilia.
Yeah.
Okay. To the map, we add Forlimpopoli in red. So you see it at the end of Via Emilia. It's 1 hour drive from Bologna. It is 1 hour drive from Rimini and the sea. It is very, very close to Forlì, which is a bigger town compared to Forlimpopoli, where you can find a very interesting museum, Museo San Domenico. It is in an ancient abbey, and nowadays it is transformed as a museum, and they always organize very interesting art exhibitions.
Cool.
Not too far from Ravenna, the capital of mosaics, the unique cities with 8 UNESCO heritage sites represented by churches decorated with mosaics. And also the surrounding of Forlimpopoli can offer you a beautiful landscape. We are in a hilly part of the region. It is the land of vineyards. It is the land of Sangiovese wine, our traditional red wine. You know Sangiovese? Well, let me tell you something. You definitely all know Chianti wine, the famous Tuscan wine, red wine from Tuscany. But Chianti is the brand, is not the grape. Chianti wine is made by Sangiovese grape. That's very important. So Sangiovese is exactly the wine you can find on the other side of the Apennine, which are the natural border between Emilia-Romagna and Tuscany. Yes. So let's come and taste our beautiful red wine from this side as well, because it tastes really wonderfully. And it's perfect with tagliatelle, with ragù sauce, with meat sauce.
Siamo pronti.
Oh, siamo pronti.
Oh,
okay.
Here we go.
Galla.
So we are ready when the pasta is coming
rising
on top of your boiling water. Either you throw it in a colander in this way for TV reason. we do it this way. We obviously prepared the ragù alla bolognese in advance because it has a long, long preparation. It needs to cook for at least 80 minutes, but sometimes even more. We just reheated the ragù in a pan
God.
We mix it together. Now we let the pasta jump. Saltiamo la pasta.
Yeah, of course.
Delicious.
Yes, it's 1 o'clock here. Just this is cruel. This is
I can imagine. I'm sorry about that.
No, you're not. Perfect.
It's true, I'm not.
It's incredible.
Okay. Oh, you know what? It smells of Sunday morning.
Of course it does.
Where grandma was boiling the ragu in the kitchen. It's really delicious. Yeah, it reminds me of my childhood. These are our perfume.
No, if I might interject for a second, I think one thing I think it's important to you already said it, but to make a stronger case is the fact that the experience there is really for a home cook. It's a celebration of the home cook or the traditions of cooking. This isn't sort of like this concocted sort of beautiful recipe, but the mind of a very creative chef. This is somebody who thought it was a very important and integral part of the history of Italy, really to preserve regional recipes, traditions. And as even we see the way she made the pasta, I think it's extraordinary to see how even the fact that the saving every little pieces find different ways to create even new pasta. It was not like, you know, really this is something wasn't supposed to be. No, they actually meant to do it so that even a smaller part find the right place and find the right recipe. So I always celebrate this sort of presentation, or moreover this way to interpret in this case the food tradition, because it really is a perfect sort of zoom in of the way Italians sort of behave and live their life and how the history moved along the years, just so attached to what they have in front of them and try to make the best out of it. So
exactly.
I really like the fact that this is a home cooking
Exactly. That I was saying, we really try to keep Artusi's legacy on, but this is what Casa Artusi is making, but the same philosophy, the same concept you can find everywhere in any cooking class spread out in Emilia Romagna. Related to the traditional recipes of their local cities, the local part of the region, but you really can have a touch of authentic Italian cuisine everywhere you go, or tasting the beautiful local product, or trying to taste the beautiful local recipes.
Amazing. I'm so hungry.
I think that meanwhile you received, or you will, the recipe of tagliatelle and also of ragù.
Perfect.
We posted, we added in the chat.
Grazie.
So we will be very, very happy. If
we would much rather for you to post the actual pasta, to be honest with you.
Please,
I think
do
we'll
it.
Check it as a second one.
We would be very happy to see your effort, to see what you could manage with these two recipes. Well, basically, if you think that ragù sauce is too difficult, you can, with tagliatelle is very good, a tomato sauce with peas, a mushroom sauce, any kind of sauce that your creativity suggests. If you prepare your homemade tagliatelle, please share it on Facebook and Instagram using our hashtags, Food Valley in Emilia Romagna, Casa Artusi, or Casa Artusi 200. Oh, by the way, I didn't tell that. This year is the bicentenary of Artusi's birth. He was born in 1820. And what I also forgot is to tell you that the Artusi book nowadays is translated in 9 foreign languages. That's amazing, isn't it?
So there's no excuse. But I think it's also incredible how quick it is, because you always, you know, think it is as an insurmountable mountain to think you're cooking from scratch. You know, the pasta, yes, but I have to go get the pasta. The idea that you can actually make it, besides the fact that it's, you know, it's fun, as we just said, and unfortunately for us, everything we have right now, it's time, because we have a lot of debt, have no way to do it. But honestly, I think it's also extraordinary, really, how quickly it is. And of course, the taste of it is just really remarkably different, of course, from the store-bought either sauce or pasta or making it from scratch at home.
Yeah, definitely. Patience and time are the best ingredient in kitchen. as Francine was saying, for aceto balsamico, for balsamic vinegar, is really a question of time. But in any case, I think for any kind of recipes, you have to take your time to leave all the troubles outside the kitchen and to concentrate of what on what you are preparing. So if there are any more questions, if you would like to have some secrets from Carla,
yes,
we are
ready to
answer.
So let's start. I have a question immediately, like if you want to do the fresh pasta, but you make more than what you're actually going to eat right now, what is the best way to preserve the extra pasta for days to come? What is the best way to do it?
Ah, se prepari pasta in più, per conservarla, com'è il modo migliore?
Direttamente in freezer.
Ah, okay. You don't leave it in the fridge. You prepare it, and if you have something left, you put it in the freezer.
Freezer.
Okay,
got
in a deep freezer. Yeah. So.
And then when it's time to cook it, you can throw it directly in the water frozen,
exactly.
Or you have to defrost it.
Exactly. No, don't defrost it. You put it into boiling water, and it will be so tasty as it would be fresh.
So there's no microwave involved. Okay, go ahead.
No microwave.
No, just to be. Confirm. Sorry, I think I interrupt you, Carla.
No. Quando la butti direttamente in acqua la pasta,
sì,
e l'hai tolta dal freezer, lasciala qualche minuto senza toccarla perché si rompe.
Ah, okay. Once you put it already still freezed into boiling water, don't move it with a fork, which is something that we usually do. When you throw the pasta, then with a fork, you mix it. So wait a little bit because it's very hard, so it will break. And you know, we never cut the tagliatelle or spaghetti, so they still has to be long as they are from the beginning, okay? So you wait a little bit.
Let me see. Other technical question. Can you use the 00 flour for the 00 flour for this?
Allora, di solito preferiamo una organic flour, una farina organica. Quindi uno ha un sapore e comunque bio e è molto più healthy.
Ma è un problema di sapore o di consistenza,
no,
di lavorazione?
Soprattutto di consistenza, di gusto quando la mangi e di benessere perché è un prodotto più naturale.
Well, they are very very attentive. Here in Casa Artusi they always use organic ingredients, local ingredients from local producers, flour as well. So they prefer organic flour. It tastes better and it gives you a better consistency of the dough.
Perfect. The other question I have, I think it's related. You kind of answered it, but I think it's more comprehensive. As I mentioned before, thinking of the stop at the Artusi, Casa Artusi, as one of the many, sightseeing or the many stops that a potential client can do in the area. They are asking, so when is the best time to maximize sort of the time of the guests there to be able to get to as many local festival as possible, let's say in the area around for Rimpopoli, for Forlì, Bologna, Ravenna. So when do you think strategically is the best time to come to get
so
the
if
best?
if you're not interested in a bathing season, so if your focus is on food and wine products, and above all, festivals. I would say the best time is springtime, but above all, autumn. In autumn, there are many, many food festivals. It's harvest time, so also many festivals dedicated to new wines, to other products like olives. We have wonderful olive oil in our region as well. Not all, not everywhere in the region, but in particular area of the region, like Brisighella, a wonderful little town close to Ravenna, they have a top quality olive oil. So in autumn, there are the highest number of food festivals.
All right, perfect. Thank you. There's a lot of in the chat line where they really, really enjoyed it. And like me, they're upset that they cannot have it, but that's another question. Let me see here. We did it. So I think we are. There's another question, which I think Francine already went through it, but probably just to give a better idea. Again, if you can explain what DOP and IOG mean, that's the specific question that it was asked from one of our listeners. Francine, you want to take that, or you want to do it, Sylvia, either one of them?
What those designations mean is that the food comes from a particular place, so it's geographic denominazione di origine protetta. Mm-hmm. How do you pronounce that?
Exactly like you did.
So that's why the DOP, in English we do it differently. I like keeping DOP. And so it's showing that that product, only from a very specific area, receives this designation because there are so many strict rules. Also, the terroir comes through in the flavor. Brisighella oil, the first DOP olive oil in all of Europe, only tastes that way because it grows there with that soil, the wind, the air, the sun that's particular to there. And so those two designations are really about the geographic spot. And although you can eat them away from there, they're always best having them right there in Emilia Romagna.
Fantastic. I mean, I don't know if you have anything more to add, but I think that once again, I want to make the strong case that yes, it's true, like Francine said, you can get most of the ingredients here, but honestly, and this is not really try to push, although this is what we do, you know, we want you to travel there, but there is something very unique to actually first and foremost seeing firsthand, you know, the ability to actually make these things. And also there's a very easy to spot connection between this product, this traditional way of making the recipe, and the beautiful sort of experience to have a meal surrounded by the place where these ingredients come from. It just really makes it all around a really unique experience. And I think Francine, as myself now that, you know, had to travel to go back to Italy, is something that we cherish quite a bit because it's something you take back home in ways that only people that travel knows.
And I would say that the best way to appreciate this kind of recipe is first to learn the procedures of some typical product. For example, Parmigiano Reggiano is so fascinating to see how Parmigiano Reggiano is made, because the consortium Parmigiano Reggiano, they say Parmigiano Reggiano is not produced, it is made, because it is still a hand procedure. So yes, once you learn about that, once you learn about the Parma ham or other cheese or other product, and then you taste the local recipe, then you appreciate even more the taste and the effort everything, all the atmosphere.
If I can just add one thing about Parmigiano Reggiano, because when you go to anywhere near Parma, it is a must to visit. It can be arranged through the consortium. You go early in the morning, you see the milk being delivered, you can smell that milk is delicious, and you see that it's made with just three ingredients and no special machinery, really. The cheesemakers, their hands know when the curds and whey are perfect, and before your eyes, it's better than any magic show in Las Vegas. All of this milk comes together into these two fantastic rounds, and then you can watch the progress that it makes into the salt bath and then onto the shelves where it's aged. The aromas, seeing the expertise and the love that's put into it, there is nothing like it. It will change you forever. When you take that piece of Parmigiano Reggiano and you grate it over pasta, or you cut it and eat it, you will never experience a meal in the same way.
Perfect.
To add this information, because it's something really new. The consortium of Parmigiano Reggiano just presented the so-called Parmigiano Reggiano experience. As Francine was saying before, you could book your visit through the consortium or calling directly the diary, which is was not so easy for a foreign tourist. Now, going to the website, parmigianoreggiano.it, and in the English version, and in the section Book Your Visit, you can really choose your diary in an interactive map and through a searching well, values, you can choose what is the best experience for you. Very easy to book now a Parmigiano-Reggiano experience. So not to be missed.
Perfect. So I think now we can close. We can let our agents go home and make the pasta. But before I want to do that, I want to, of course, a shameless plug on top of the Artusi, of course, 200th anniversary. Also, this year, we are celebrating the 100th year of the creation of the Italian National Tourism Board. So it's a shameless plug about what we do. So we invite all our agents, especially during this beautiful sort of time that we're not going to see each other, to go in to the link that they have found that they're going to see in their chat line and to visit. We created a virtual experience where you can see the 100 years, what we have done. And moreover, example of some of this creative work that you might have seen sometimes in this calendar that they have around the world. These are travel poster. And this beautiful art that is sort of inviting during the 20s, 30s, and 40s, and 50s people back to Italy, which are really extraordinary. So I hope you have a chance to go and see the link at this, and they're going to see examples, something like this. There are, again, things, expression of what the Italian Tourism Board has done for 100 years. So I want to thank Francine. I want to thank Silvia. Of course, Carla, thank you very much. It looks so easy, and I know it's not. You are going to be responsible so many frequinche that they're going to be so dirty and people are just swearing. It looks so easy. Why is it not easy? You know, it takes practice, but you're going to get there. So I want to, again, thank all of you. Of course, thanks, again, the ambassador for endorsing this specific venture, Mr. And also, of course, my director, the director, Mr. Bastianelli. To all the attendees, thank you very much. You will get some feedback email. Please give us some sort of sense if you like this presentation, if you want anything to be changed, if you have other questions. We'll make sure that all your questions will be answered, or at least they will be delivered to the right people. People, finally, this is, of course, a lot of people working on this. I want to thank my colleague from Toronto, Sabrina and Salvatore, from our Los Angeles office, Emanuela and Fabrizio, and of course, from our New York office, Caterina, Cosmo and Marzia. Thank you very much. I'll see you the next one. And for the people, I'm going to say happy Thanksgiving. Ciao. See you the next one.
Ciao. Buon appetito.